Flashpoints are community interfaces where the two traditions, Republican and Unionist, exist, divided only by street or peace line. There are numerous flashpoints in the city of Belfast. Simply crossing the street transforms you into a different country with completely opposing political ideology and aspirations. Flashpoints are the barometer for the current status of the peace process. Belfast has become an international metaphor for troubled hotspots in the world. These hotspots are like swirling vortexes of negative energy that escalate and sweep over everyone, resulting in devastation.
Lives are here are better than they once were. Far from perfect, we've a long way to go. But it nevertheless is an interesting story of how a society moves from one of violence to one of addressing its conflict through politics alone.
The 800-year-old Anglo-Irish conflict is at its Rubicon as politicians and communities strive to find a new peaceful beginning for the people of Northern Ireland. The Unionists in the northern six counties known as Ulster wish to remain part of Britain, and the Nationalists want to unite with the rest of the southern 26 counties of Ireland. The modern troubles started in 1968. Since then, almost 4,000 people have lost their lives. In 1998, the Good Friday Agreement was signed. The foundation of the agreement was to remove barriers of distrust and promote respect for the equal rights of both traditions.
It's easily described as our British problem. The problem of our nearest neighbors claiming ownership initially of Ireland, and now hundreds of years later of this part of Ireland. And you can't actually even understand anything that's happened here at any time, whether on the island of Ireland as a whole or in this part of the island, unless you see it in the context of the conquest of Ireland by an English government. The issue can be whittled down to British policy towards Ireland.
The Northern Ireland-Irish conflict is a conflict that is a spillover, if I might use that expression, from the Reformation, in that the Reformation never really touched Ireland, that is, those that were Irish speakers. Unfortunately, the Bible was not printed in Irish. And those people were robbed of what was taking place in England, Scotland, and Wales. It would be very hard to find out now who are Irish, you know, because there was such a mixture in this island. But it is not right to say that every Protestant is a unionist, and it's not right to say that every Roman Catholic is a Republican.
You know, you have to go onto the streets, in a sense, you know, while the conflict is, you know, the violent dimensions of the conflict, in order to make sure that you know really what's driving it, the dynamics of it, which may not be what you think are the dynamics. I mean, everybody took it for granted that the IRA were fighting for a united Ireland. Whereas when you get close to what's actually happening, you discover that what they're really fighting about is equality for the nationalist community in the north. And they believed that they would never get equality under a British system.
It stretches back many hundreds of years, but specifically within the last century, has come about because of the partition of Ireland against the overwhelming wishes of the people of Ireland, and the fact that as a result of that partition, for many decades, majority rule obtained in the north, and the ethos of those who ruled the north, in their own words, was effectively a Protestant parliament for a Protestant people.
When a line was drawn through part of Ireland and said that part is going to be governed by Britain. So it was an unnatural division. And for every decade subsequently, there was, in some shape or form, a revolution against what the British had imposed on the Irish people.
I think it's two sets of idiots slugging each other out over who owns a land that none of them will ever properly own without sharing. That may sound simplistic, but I don't know for sure how generation after generation after generation can carry its bitternesses, its ghosts, its myths, its shibboleths. But we do, and we have. Sectarianism and division are not flowers that grow wild in a field. They're nurtured in the window box or the potting shed and passed on generation to generation. And if that is the case, and if I'm right, the responsibility then of people who want to change this society and try and modernize this society have a responsibility to take those flowers out by the roots. And it seems to me that one of the ways in which we can begin the process of doing that is to know each other.
Well, the division among the people of Ireland is what the conflict was about. They're divided basically about their identity. By and large, the Protestant people who are largely concentrated in the north of Ireland regard themselves as British, and the Catholic people regard themselves as Irish. So the basic conflict was not about religion, but about the identity factor.
Given that we've been killing each other for around about 800 years, and unable to create peace, it was fairly clear that we couldn't do it on our own. We certainly wouldn't have gotten this far without not just George Mitchell, but that concept that he carried of assistance, help.
When I say the people of Northern Ireland, I don't mean every single person in Northern Ireland. There are still some on both sides who regard any compromise as a sellout of their view. There are still some on both sides who are what I call 100%ers. They have to have 100% of their way, or they won't participate. That's true in every society. There will be some violence, but no society in all of human history has ever been able to achieve the complete absence of violence.
There are borders at the end of many of our streets, never mind the constitutional border that we have. There are borders in our minds. The separation and division is absolute almost. 93% of all of our society live homogeneously Protestant or Catholic, nationalist, unionist, loyalist or Republican.
The red hand on the Ulster flag represents the hand of an invading army soldier who cut off his hand and threw it ashore from an incoming ship in order to win a contest to be the first man to touch the Ulster coast.
When you studied our problem, there were two mentalities. And you find these mentalities in a lot of areas of conflict. On the one hand, there was a unionist mentality, and the unionists wanted to protect their identity and their ethos, and they have every right to do that. It's their methods that we quarreled with.
The tricolour from the Irish Republic represents both traditions, with white in the middle representing peace.
Republicanism is a perfectly legitimate aspiration. I would argue, of course, that the expression of republicanism as violence is not a perfectly legitimate aspiration.
Oh, I do understand the nationalists. I understand their grievances. And I understand, well, it is as legitimate as the Protestant king.
That people living just on the other side in the streets over the peace line should think that we were kind of hostile towards them, you know. There was a door in the peace line, kind of a gate to which you could go through. And I can remember saying to myself, well, the houses here look exactly like the houses on the other side, you know. So this woman, I'd say she was maybe about 60, opened the door. And she was a bit taken aback when she saw me because I was wearing a collar and all that, you know. And then she said, I said, I'm from the monastery over there. And she said, come in. So I went in and I was feeling, you know, a bit apprehensive. So when I was crossing over the door, over the threshold, I saw this plaque, if you'd call it, a kind of a wall hanging. And it was over the door going into the kitchen, you know, from the front room. And it said, love one another. And I can remember saying to myself, well, no, I recognize that anyway.
So it was in prison basically where I began to challenge the ideals of violence. Mandela, for instance, he manifested his political ideals within prison. And in many other conflicts throughout the world, prison has been the catalyst for peace. And that would be no different in Northern Ireland. I mean, when I was in prison, I think people started to question as to why they're in there in the first place, why they did what they did, and why they chose violence.
I thought then of the Birmingham bombings. I mean, I was in prison when that happened. You know, your first reaction was the big bomb in England, you know, and you're going, right, good, and then hold on a minute, and then you start to hear what it's about. And I kind of can't remember anybody. I'm talking about 90 Republicans in a cage in Long Cage at the time. Nobody felt like celebrating that incident, you know, because it was civilians killed. And civilians are going to be killed in wars, but and that type of attack, and what you don't do is use civilians.
If I was born a nationalist, I probably would have been in the IRA. The same as a fate of birth if you're born a Catholic or a Protestant for you, because when you went into the Protestant community, you had a mirror image in the Catholic community. So I'm quite convinced if I was born a Catholic and lived in the Falls Road, I would have been in the IRA. And I'd have been in prison and maybe shot dead.
Every other avenue was tried and tested, and I think they've always believed that every conflict has a political solution. You know, violence is used as a means, almost like propaganda, to draw attention. I mean, no one was listening here to what was happening. Our neighbourhoods were being burnt down. The Unionists and British had complete control of the media and what sort of information was getting out. And it was only when, you know, the IRA started to take sort of an active role in sort of their commercial bombs and stuff like this, then people started to listen and pick up, what was the problem there?
There have been scores and scores and scores of killings and beatings and attacks since the peace process and the ceasefires were declared. In fact, the ceasefires don't really exist. They exist to give the British government an excuse to say there is a peace process. But you've only to listen to the radio in the morning here, and you hear about people being murdered, people being shot in the legs, people being knifed. I mean, where is the peace?
That mixture of people feeling that an identity is either being denied or threatened, and that an interest is being subjugated or is being undermined, those are the fears and the frustrations and the misgivings and the senses of grievance that have been feeding the conflict.
Guiding a constituency through massive change is the tallest order a politician must face. Damage to buildings cannot compare to that of human cost, but it still fulfills its purpose of driving a dagger into the serenity of the affected neighborhood. Just a few hours before this footage was taken, the regulars of this pub were enjoying a pint and one another's company. Tonight, this burnt-out building will be a monument for retaliation. Residents of conflict zones are shell-shocked, numbing themselves to the omnipresent threat of violence that can happen anytime, any place, against anyone. Communities will ultimately remain loyal to one another during times of physical force. In circumstances like these, politics go out the window, and you're left with the man standing next to you. Out of the 1.6 million people in Northern Ireland, it takes just a tiny fraction from each side to keep these flashpoints thriving.
Live as close together as 50 metres apart. If our trajectory is good, we can hit each other. If our voices are loud, we can hear each other, but we don't know each other. We can be born in separate hospitals, go to separate schools, sign on at separate unemployment exchanges, and to add insult to injury, we'll be buried in separate graveyards. we're 90 miles long by 90 miles wide.
It may appear as if there is no content to these actions, but the aggressive nature of man surfaces when frustration has no recourse. Although progress has been made, it stems from living what seems to be the same day over and over for 30 years. Impatience evolves into anger, which builds into the urge for revenge. Revenge is then sought in demonstrations against authorities and communities through civil disobedience. These actions are desperate attempts to awaken those in power to the necessity for social change. The fire that burns in the psychological realm of man can ruin the possibility for peace with its desire for vengeance, or lead these communities to a powerful transformation. Both sides are conflicted with the terror of becoming a victim and the desire to end the hostilities. Seeing through the eyes of a perceived enemy and to accommodate the needs of an opposing viewpoint takes great courage.
And I'd say he was maybe his mid-20s, and he had a brick in his hand. And I was annoyed at this thing, and I went up to him, and I said to him, when did this start? Because I was trying to find out what happened. Why they were doing it. I said, when did this start? And he looked down at me with a kind of a look of contempt, I remember. He said, this started the first day the English put their foot in this country. So I went down and I was thinking, we're in trouble.
Attention, this is the police warning.
The divine penchant for revenge is expressed in Leviticus chapter 24, verse 20. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. The injury and disfigurement that he has inflicted upon another shall in turn be inflicted upon him. For some, vengeance is a form of spirituality, a sort of spiritual power to equalize social injustice. When we seek vengeance, we are apt to feel we have some sort of divine justification for our actions. Since we have been hurt, we feel the right to get back at our persecutors. Abused people often feel they only have two choices. Either they go numb, or they become abusers themselves. You were acting like it was the end of the world. Despite these images, Belfast no longer produces Jerusalem-style headlines. The majority of paramilitaries have stood down, large-scale bombings have stopped, and death rates from the conflict have dropped. Unless both communities can fully experience and comprehend the distrust that separates them, hidden enmities will smolder unendingly. When these flames flare up and consume their fuel, a thrilling moment exists to seize an opportunity to put down the sword and begin to understand one another. Those who have the courage to put violence behind them and embrace democracy can traverse deeply entrenched obstacles that are part of the very fabric of their community and create a better future for their children.
But the important thing is what's in people's hearts and minds.
Right.
Are people committed to the democratic process? Are they truly and meaningfully prepared to renounce the use or threat of force as a way to resolve political issues and decide them in the democratic and political arena? That's what matters.
Same thing. When you consider that in the 30 years that have gone past, 1 out of 500 people died in Northern Ireland, and 1 out of 50 people were maimed and injured.
Since the Troubles began over 30 years ago, these sort of things have always have a detrimental effect. Common sense will tell you that it's not good public relations. It sends a terrible image. It has to be understood, however, that we're talking here, however unpleasant those particular incidents are, you're talking about a tiny, tiny geographical area of Northern Ireland. I mean, a couple of square miles, basically. Now, that doesn't diminish in any way the significance of what is happening there.
So I've said publicly on many occasions that a delegation from the Northern Ireland Assembly could stand favorable comparison to any parliamentary body in the democratic world, including the United States Congress or the United States Senate or other major parliaments. So they're very able people.
I was always totally and absolutely opposed to violence. And I think it's common sense to be opposed to violence. When you consider that our problem is, as I have often said, that we are a divided people, not a divided piece of earth. I don't believe that you can seek to achieve human rights for your people if your method undermines the most fundamental human right of all, the right to life.
To examine and to explore what peace means. What is it? What exactly is peace about? Then how do you get to it? And who has a responsibility to chart a course towards that? And is there an alternative? Can you say to people who are engaged in physical force, look, here's an alternative. You don't have to be involved in physical force. Here's an alternative. And who is the biggest challenge to? The biggest challenge is for the people who have power. So it becomes the British government, it becomes church leaders, it becomes labour leaders, it becomes civic society leaders, it becomes governments, it becomes people involved in armed actions, it becomes society as a whole.
That there is always a way forward when you're trying to resolve a conflict. Always, no matter how impossible. Provided you approach it with respect for the dignity of the human person.
I've never experienced childbirth, but the next most painful thing in life has to be self-analysis. Why did I hate people that I didn't know? Why could I easily vilify and detest people who were just like me? And we need to remember that not everybody in Northern Ireland has been involved in the conflict at the level of violence. The vast majority of people have repudiated and stood apart from, aside from, loyalist violence, republican violence.
The world is only beginning to discover the unlimited potential of these sophisticated and dynamic people who inhabit the northern six counties of Ireland.
But I believe, most importantly, that the people of Northern Ireland have irrevocably chosen the path of peace, made a decision to resolve their differences through peaceful and democratic dialogue and not through violence.
Human beings suffer. They torture one another. They get hurt and they get hard. No poem or play or song can fully right a wrong inflicted and endured.
Well, I think it's a realizable dream. And that is obviously an island which is at peace with itself, a national republic on the island. And also one where we can have good relationships with our nearest offshore island, that we can actually have a good mutually interdependent life with people in Britain.
The innocent in goals beat on their bars together. A hunger striker's father stands in the graveyard dumb. The police widow in veils faints at the funeral home.
And it's not really the Irish way. It's, I believe, the universal way and the only way to solve a conflict, no matter what the conflict is. And it's first of all dialogue in that sense between all the parties. Dialogue then leads to negotiation. Between all the participants. I think that's very, very important. Between all the participants, the dialogue leads into negotiation, leads into an agreement, and the agreement has to accommodate the rights of all the participants.
History says, don't hope on this side of the grave. But then, once in a lifetime, the longed-for tidal wave of justice can rise up and hope and history rhyme.
Principle number one, respect for difference. No victory for either side. Respect for both identities. Principle number two, institutions that respect differences.
a proportionally elected assembly so that all sections are there, a proportionally elected government so that all sections of people are there. And then the third principle, working together in our common interests, which are largely economic, real politics. And by doing that, the new Ireland will evolve.
So hope for a great sea change on the far side of revenge. Believe that a further shore is reachable from here. Believe in miracles and cures and healing wells.
This is a fledgling assembly that you're in at the moment. The executive that I'm part of is a fledgling executive. So we have to continue to work at it. And of course, the key mechanism for doing that is dialogue, debate and discussion. And the more people come in contact with one another, then the easier it is for us to break down barriers. And
politicians should do the things that politicians think they cannot do.
Call the miracle self-healing, the utter self-revealing double take of feeling. If there's fire on the mountain, or lightning and storm, and a god speaks from the sky, that means someone is hearing the outcry and the birth cry of new life at its term.
My dream is for my grandson to look at a human being and wonder how that human being feels this day, how that friend feels this day, and to have no concept of the need to identify where they live, what their religion is, or whether they're a threat. That's the dream. Everything else flows from that.
I can say to you that there are times in the affairs of men when things come together.
Sense of humour. And I think we have to give people in various parties more credit for having a sense of humour than often appears to be allowed. People know that Ian Paisley can have a certain sense of humour, a bit vicious at times, but can have a certain sense of humour. But it isn't always vicious, and he can make fun of himself.
So I think that people realise that I'm not the ogre I'm supposed to be. But really, I don't mind that. I mean, if people feel that I'm going to bite them, well, that's all right. It doesn't hurt my teeth because I'll not be biting them.
Might be no harm. Keep me straight up anyway. It'll stop me falling back, going to sleep. All right?
Okay.
Are we all right?
Yep, great. You look great.
Okay. Well, let her go.
I have enjoyed the crack, which has a totally different meaning here. And the capacity for, even in the middle of all the messing, the capacity for humour.
Okay. Are you all set?
Yeah, I'm all set, yeah.
In your own words...
How do you want me to sit here?
That's
whatever
way you're comfortable. You're
Hello? Yes. Kathy. Yes, talk away. Yeah, I'm already in the middle of an interview, that's all. Go on. What do you want?
Why did you use the term Damascus? Yeah. So are you seeking canonization? Are you have you been redeemed?
I mean, for instance, a Protestant position. How do you tell 700 million Catholics they're wrong? And even if you thought it was worth the breath in your body to make the effort, will they listen?
Right, exactly.
You know, this absurd circumstance that all somehow we have the rightness, you know.
Right.
And it's all based upon where you might go and find out at some later point. Having said that, most of the practitioners I know of religion in Northern Ireland, sure as hell ain't going to fucking heaven. Because you see, if I get to the party gates and they're in there, I'll be saying, no.
The simpler dream, which is unrealizable, is to have a month off.
Have a month off?
Yeah.
Okay, I think you've enough.